Now, the media has glorified vitamin D, aka the sunshine vitamin, and has labeled it as the cure-all for seemingly everything from depression to cancer and everything under the sun, no pun intended. Well, let's review why vitamin D is important, who should get their blood levels tested, and how much is enough. Like your vitamin D, you don't want to miss this. If it's your first time here, I'm Dr. Majd. Consider subscribing to this channel for up-to-date medical topics and headlines. So why do we need vitamin D? Well, ingested vitamin D helps the body absorb calcium from the intestines and into the bloodstream and is important for overall bone health. It also suppresses the parathyroid hormone that tends to break down our bone. Insufficiency of vitamin D can contribute to osteoporosis, which is low bone density that can increase fracture risk. Fractures later in life, especially of the hip, can significantly impair quality of life and functioning. As far as its claims to cure fatigue, depression, cancer, heart disease, and etc., no good scientific evidence to back up these claims. Also note that supplements in general are not FDA approved, so their safety is not always well established and their claims often go unchecked. The vitamin industry is quite savvy at marketing itself, so make sure to obtain the facts before you initiate any supplement in general, and pick your doctor's brain prior. Now, how much vitamin D do we need? Well, the typical healthy adult needs about 800 international units of vitamin D daily. For instance, elderly homebound patients may need a little more. Therefore, if you are a normal risk adult, you don't necessarily need your blood levels checked, only to simply maintain this daily intake every day, whether it is through the diet or supplement or both. Note that vitamin D does have a toxicity level, so don't take excessive amounts. However, up to 2,000 international units daily have been generally found to be safe. Supplements are sold in two forms, in cholecalciferol, which is vitamin D3, or ergocalciferol, which is vitamin D2. D3 is preferred over D2, however, because it's the more naturally occurring form of the vitamin with improved absorption rates. In addition to vitamin D, calcium is a key player in bone health. So for premenopausal women, 1,000 milligrams of calcium in divided doses is also recommended. The recommendation is slightly higher, 1200 milligrams for postmenopausal women and all men. Again, it's best to obtain your nutrients through your diet, and calcium is found in many food sources. And I've actually covered this topic in the past, and I'll put the link in the description down below too. So what are the sources of vitamin D? Well, there are two main sources. First of all, your diet. If you have watched my YouTube videos prior, you know that I always say that it's best to obtain your nutrients from your diet rather than from a supplement. Dietary sources of vitamin D include fatty fish such as salmon, herring, and sardines, egg yolk, mushrooms, fortified cereals, and fortified cow's milk. Now, you can obtain about 100 international units in general in like an 8-ounce cup of milk, while 3 ounces of cooked salmon contains about 570 international units. If you don't tend to consume these foods regularly, however, it may be a reason for vitamin D insufficiency, and supplementation may be indicated. The second source is through your skin. Believe it or not, you can also produce vitamin D underneath your skin when exposed to sunlight, hence why we refer to it as the sunshine vitamin. However, the amount of sunlight necessary to produce sufficient amounts varies with location, with season, and the time of day. So peak sun rays are like somewhere between 11 a.m. and 3 p.m. And those who live in the northern latitude, above the imaginary line between, like, let's say Philadelphia and San Francisco, may have a greater challenge obtaining enough UV rays in the winter. Sunscreen may also limit vitamin D absorption, but that doesn't mean that we should be foregoing protecting ourselves from skin cancer either. Skin production also varies depending on the skin color and the age of the person. Those who have darker skin may require more sunlight. And also, age is another factor. As we grow older, our skin production diminishes. According to the National Institute of Health, approximately 5 to 30 minutes of sun exposure, either daily or at least twice a week, to exposed face, arms, hands, and legs is typically sufficient for most people. But beware, before you decide to fry your skin lathered in baby oil like we used to do in my day, as you do not want to exchange vitamin D for skin cancer, like I was saying. And tanning beds are certainly not recommended. Now, what are normal vitamin D levels? Well, one of the challenges of measuring blood vitamin D levels is that expert groups actually do not even agree on what should be normal. Some say a level of 20 should be the threshold, and others say 30. Who should be tested? Well, severe vitamin D deficiencies are rare in developed countries like the US, but mild insufficiencies are actually fairly common. Some of the lowest vitamin D levels in the world have been found in people in the Middle East and South Asia. Infants and children and elderly are two other at-risk groups, along with those who don't consume sufficient dairy products, have medical conditions that diminish the absorption of vitamin D through the gut, or medical conditions that impair vitamin D metabolism. But if you are relatively healthy and live in Southern California or other sunny parts of the world, should you even be worried about vitamin D levels since we tend to get more sun exposure? Well, this brings me to my next question. Who should be tested? Not everyone needs their vitamin D levels checked, despite all of the media hype. There is no good evidence that screening like younger, healthy people is even beneficial at this point. Because of this lack of available data, many insurance plans decline to cover the cost of the blood test. And it is a very costly test, I have to admit. I'd say maybe several hundred dollars or so out of pocket if they don't cover it. Medical expert groups recommend testing of the following at-risk groups, the top populations that do have evidence to back up these recommendations. Elderly people with falls who are homebound or living in a nursing home or long-term care facilities. People with intestinal disorders that affect the ability to absorb vitamin D through the gut, such as Crohn's disease and celiac disease. People after surgery to remove any part of the intestines, such as those with gastric bypass operations. People with kidney or liver disease, organs that help to metabolize vitamin D. And those with osteoporosis or osteopenia that were diagnosed on a bone density test. As always, be sure to discuss your health with your doctor before initiating any medication or supplement, as the info presented here is for general informational purposes only. But if you found the information valuable, which is always my goal, please give it a like, hit that red subscribe button along with that notification bell next to it so that you don't miss any of my future videos. And please feel free to share it with someone else who may find it useful. A lot of people have the same questions that you have. Thanks for tuning in. Stay healthy and sun sensational. Until next time.